Good afternoon. The next item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is transport. Again, I would always, as ever, make a plea for succinct questions and answers to match. And at question number one, I call Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment is made of any accessibility issues in relation to the Inter-Isles Air Service in Orkney and similar public service obligation operations in other island communities.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The provision of public service obligation operations in Orkney is a matter for Orkney Islands Council and Logan Air. Therefore, the Scottish Government has not assessed the accessibility of these services. But I know Logan Air are receptive to feedback on how the services could be improved for anyone who relies on them. As for the island communities, the Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland very recently wrote to, and I'm sorry, I can't pronounce this properly, so forgive me, recently wrote to Comnir-nan Eilinsiar, and I really apologise for the butchering of that name, about issues concerning the new contract with a different airline. The MAX has also written to me on the issue, and I will carefully consider the response. HITRANS, the Highlands and Islands Transport Partnership, recently convened a meeting of health boards in its area to discuss the establishment of a health and transport action plan. If the member has not already done so, I would urge Mr MacArthur to please raise these relevant issues with HITRANS.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Minister and advise him he's probably going to have to make his peace with Alistair Allen and his constituents at some point. I recently met with North Ronaldsea Community Council, Orkney Islands Council, NHS Orkney, Logan Air and others to discuss growing concerns about the accessibility of the Islander aircraft, which provides the Lifeline Air services to North Ronaldsea and other outer North Isles in my constituency. I'm told some island residents with mobility issues find the prospect of trying to get in and out of the aircraft so painful and or undignified that they are opting not to travel, often missing health and other important appointments on the Orkney mainland. So will the Minister agree to ask his officials to engage with Orkney Islands Council to see what more might be done in the context of the forthcoming re-tendering process for the Inter-Isles service to ensure that this genuine lifeline is accessible to all island residents who depend upon it?
Minister.
Yes, I can actually I can give that assurance to Liam MacArthur that we can have that conversation could be had. And I'm also aware that officials are scheduling a meeting with Corland to discuss healthcare provision in June, and we will keep members updated with those findings.
I call question number two, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government how much it spent in 2023-24 on safety improvements to trunk roads in the North East Scotland region.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Transport Scotland does not record information on local authority or parliamentary regions. It's recorded using four operating company units, North West, North East, South West and South East. Transport Scotland has spent £18.6 million on structural maintenance schemes in the North East unit in the last 12 months. £2.7 million was spent on construction of casualty reduction safety improvements to trunk roads in the North East operating company unit in 23-24.
Dr. Slumsden.
Presiding Officer, one of the best ways to improve safety would be to dual the A96 as promised by the SNP in 2011, but seemingly now we need a review. In November 22, Jenny Gilruth told us that the corridor review would be out at the end of the year. In June 23, Jenny Gilruth said the review would be out in the summer. In November 23, Shona Robson said the review would be out at the end of the year. In February 24, the Cabinet Secretary told us the review would be out in the coming months. In April of this year, the Cabinet Secretary told us that the review would be out in the coming months. Presiding Officer, this is now embarrassing and insulting to the people of the North East. Yeah. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us if we will see any construction on this project before 2026?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly there are different aspects to the A96, and clearly in terms of the Inverness to Nairn route and the dualling of that, progress has been made, and I'll be reporting that, as I have regularly been doing, to the Parliament in relation to the review. I can understand the frustrations. Some of us in government would like to see that review published sooner rather than later. We may be restricted as to what we can do, depending on what current rules over the next few weeks and months dictate. But I think it's really important to share all the information that's in that review, good, bad and different, depending on what your point of view is. But clearly the commitment of the Scottish Government has been and is to dual the A96, but certainly the improvements that we can make, we are making progress on, particularly on those points of the A96 I've just referred to.
I have received a supplementary from Claire Hawkey. I'm happy to take that, but I would, in so doing, remind Ms Hawkey that the question concerns spend on safety improvements to trunk roads in North East Scotland region. Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out some of the impacts to Scotland's trunk roads, including in the North East, of the budget cuts which Mr Lumsden's party has imposed in Scotland?
And Cabinet Secretary, when responding, please deal with the bit of the question that relates to North East Scotland region trunk roads. Thank you.
So North East Scotland trunk roads rely on investment from the Scottish Government and particularly relies on capital investment. And the issues that this government is facing is a situation where, because of the mismanagement of the economy by the UK Conservative government, we are seeing an almost 9% reduction in our capital budget, and that has consequences. And the issues of infrastructure inflation and the issues of available spend for capital clearly causes difficulties, which is why it is quite remarkable with even within those constraints, I've managed to ensure as Cabinet Secretary that the much needed asset investment in our trunk roads has not been just been maintained but increased. But I don't think the Conservatives can criticise when there isn't enough capital for our budgets, whether it's on North East trunk roads, whether it's on the rest of the trunk road network, or indeed whether it's in other infrastructure projects.
Question number three, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what work it is undertaking to prepare for the introduction of low emission zones in Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Dundee.
Cabinet Secretary.
I meet regularly with the local authorities introducing low emission zones. My officials continue to work closely with them and UK government agencies such as the DVLA to assist with preparations for LEZ enforcement. Extensive national LEZ awareness raising schemes have taken place and continue across both new and traditional media, supported by work at local level by Dundee, whose enforcement starts on the 30th of May, and Aberdeen and Edinburgh, who start on June the 1st, as these cities join hundreds of other European cities and towns across Europe with similar schemes. And I can also advise that the Scottish Government has provided full funding to establish all local authority LEZ enforcement systems and continues to provide support funding to low-income households and micro-businesses preparing for LEZs, with £16.1 million being made available since 2019.
Alexander Stewart.
The Cabinet Secretary for that response. Almost a year after the low emission zone came into force in Glasgow, 40% of the Council's own vehicles failed to comply with the regulations. Given Glasgow City Council are struggling to comply with the scheme themselves, what support will be given to hard-working Scots and businesses in other locations, or is this simply a war against motorists?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the investment I referred to is £16.1 million, and I know because I checked that the member has membership, I understand, of a number of cross-party groups that are related to lung disease and health issues. So he understands that air quality is very, very important, and it's actually air quality that is the issue here. Now, one of the first lessons of politics is to learn how to count. And if you look at the area in square miles of Glasgow, it is 127 in terms of the area. The area of LEZ in square miles is 1, which the percentage area of the whole of Glasgow City Council area that is covered by the low emission zone is 0.79%. But according to the Conservative, perhaps they expect every single vehicle in all parts of Glasgow to always and all the time be in that 0.79% of that low emission zone area. So I would suspect that in areas perhaps like Outer Pollock or in other areas that those vehicles that are not compliant will not need to be compliant to go into that city centre area. But I do think that both Glasgow and indeed all the other areas are looking to decarbonise their fleet, and they're doing it in a phased way. But I think, let's be reasonable, that with less than 0.79% of the area covered, we are not surely going to expect every single vehicle in Glasgow City Council all to be in that city centre all
Thank
the
you,
time.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We have a request for three supplementaries. I intend to take all three. First supplementary from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Low emission zones take place across Europe and around 320 cities have them. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what learnings the Scottish Government has taken from the experiences of the European cities whilst developing its work for the introduction of low emission zones in Scotland's cities?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Member makes a very good point. We are not in Scotland the only country in Europe that's created low emission zones, and they are in operation in many countries and cities for a number of years, and of course London. And of course important that we learn from others' experience, and we have met with European cities and government representatives to discuss the LEZ delivery in Europe, and the officials have also reviewed many of the environmental vehicle access restriction schemes in operation across the continent, and that has helped inform the framework used for the Scottish LEZ introduction. Of course, this is normal, and this is something that many countries are doing, and indeed the issue here is improving the air quality, improving quality of life and improving quality of health for the vulnerable, particularly in our communities, young children, those with preconditions, health preconditions, and also older people.
Supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. The Liberal Democrat co-leader of Aberdeen City Council stated in writing that the decision to introduce an LEZ in Aberdeen was taken by the Scottish Parliament, not the City Council. And I asked some time ago if the Council could decide not to enforce the LEZ. I was told it was not possible. Does the Cabinet Secretary think the co-leader's assertions are entirely accurate? And is it correct that where there's been a material change in circumstances since the Council declared an LEZ, legislation does allow modification of those plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would reflect that all the cities that are carrying out low enforcement zone areas, and we're seeing Aberdeen introducing theirs, and in terms of enforcement, obviously it's been in place for some time. Dundee, Edinburgh, and obviously Glasgow has been in place for some time as well. I'm very struck by the cooperation and the support of those local authorities in doing their responsibilities and carrying out those responsibilities. In terms of modification, it may well be that the Conservatives want to roll back from low emission zones because they don't believe that air quality is important. But if they do want to support the local authority, they can do that. I've not had representations from any of the local authorities to make a modifications or amendment. I do know, for example, Glasgow extended the period for taxis to be exempt. So there are flexibilities that can be made depending on the individual circumstances. It's not for me to dictate what they are. It'll be up for the council leaders and in those particular areas to decide themselves what makes sense for their cities.
And supplementary, Fossil Charging.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've been contacted by many constituents, particularly taxi drivers, whose cars come up as eligible to drive in low emission zones when checked online. However, when they contact their council or their taxi office, they are informed their cars are in reality not eligible. Can the Minister assure me that the Scottish Government is taking action to ensure the information on LEZ vehicle eligibility checking service are accurate?
I appreciate the member raising the issue of the tracking and the checking service. It's provided on the low emission website. It's connected to the DVLA and the DVLA's definitions. If there is an anomaly between the two, it's really important that they do contact the councils. There's a million people have contacted and used that tracker. As I recall, in the very early days in Glasgow, there were situations where there may have been some, in very few circumstances, discrepancies, and that is definitely worth pursuing because they need to make sure that there's a good read-across. But it certainly has been working to date, but I would refer members to that issue, and if they can draw that attention to Transport Scotland as well, that would be quite helpful.
Question number four, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the Young Persons Under 22's free bus travel scheme was last reviewed.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over 137 million journeys have been made since the Young Persons Free Bus Travel Scheme began. And a one-year evaluation of the scheme was published in December 2023. That study showed that the scheme is making good progress towards longer-term objectives by reducing travel costs for young people and their families, encouraging a shift towards public transport from private car use, and improving access to social, leisure, education and employment opportunities. The three-year evaluation of the scheme is planned for 2025 and will have a focus on the longer-term impacts on whether behaviour changes have actually been sustained.
Audrey Nicholl.
I th- thank the Minister for his response, and I know from young constituents the immense benefit the scheme has brought to their lives. For one, it has opened up social, educational opportunities and allowed him to travel more widely, where that was previously limited due to a health condition. However, other young constituents have expressed concern regarding aspects of the application process, specifically difficulties providing proof of address due to their young age, and some technical issues using the face scanner, which had to be repeatedly used before it would work. So can I ask the Minister what further steps the Scottish Government can take to improve and streamline the application process to ensure that it's accessible and user-friendly, and encourage continued uptake of this successful and important scheme?
Cabinet Secretary. Oh, I'm sorry, Minister.
We have been acutely aware since the introduction of the free bus travel for under-22s that applying for their entitlement is challenging for some children and young people. And that's why early on we listened carefully to what families and young people themselves were telling us and worked with the improvement services to make improvements. We've also worked hard to ensure that children, parents and young people know that there are a number of different ways to apply, not just online, and that local authorities continue to process offline applications and have dedicated staff on hand to support anyone who may need additional support. Some have also increased the availability of applications through schools, and we keep the application process under review, so if there are changes that Ms Nicholl thinks should be made, I would be very happy to meet with her to discuss those, as well as the particular circumstances of our constituent, to see if we can resolve these.
Supplementary, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. When I held a members' debate in December on the issue of antisocial behaviour by a minority of people using the free bus travel scheme, the Cabinet Secretary committed to looking at the issue and reporting back to Parliament. Now, that hasn't happened yet, but I understand that a working group has been set up. So can the Minister tell us how many times that group has met? What is its remit? And when can we expect to hear any progress?
Minister.
Yeah, we're absolutely aware that there have been some incidents of antisocial behaviour that have been linked to the introduction of the Young Person's Free Pass and Travel Scheme. And it's important to remember the vast majority of people use the bus properly. And one of the concerns that I have about this scheme and the fact that this issue keeps coming up, quite rightly, and I'm not saying that it shouldn't be, is the fact that people get the impression that all young people are behaving badly, and that's absolutely not the case. So the Antisocial Behaviour Scotland Act provides a wide range of measures for dealing with all antisocial behaviour, including dispersal orders. But in answer to the question directly, we will report back to you with details of it, and I'll give you that in writing so that we can give you the proper facts.
And always through the
proper facts.
And always through the chair, please. And a supplementary, Alec Reddy.
Presiding Officer, the Fairs Fairs review, as well as committing to the continuation of the free travel for the under-22s, stated as a short-term action that the government would develop a proposal for a bus flat fares pilot. Can the Minister advise what progress has been made, and is there a timeline in place for this?
Minister.
As Alec Reddy will be well aware, this is a deregulated sector, so we've got to do some scoping work to be able to look at what that the flat fare review will look like. But as that develops, I'll be more than happy to meet with the member and we can discuss how the progress is happening.
Question number five, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what representations it can make to Loganair to ensure that my constituents in Hailan and Nyer are not disadvantaged as a result of recent changes to flight timetables.
Minister Jim Fairley.
I commend Alistair Allen for his ability to see these words, Mr Allen. Like all airlines, Loganair continuously reviews capacity and schedules to ensure the most efficient use of their aircraft. In doing so, they have regard to the needs of the communities they serve to try to find the optimum connectivity for all. This is because over the course of a day, an aircraft can be used to serve the Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland and other routes. We understand the recent changes are intended to improve the overall resilience of the network, in particular reliability and punctuality. Ultimately, these are decisions for Loganair, but I know they will welcome representations from the customers on how to further improvement, make further improvements.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Recent changes to the Stornoway to Inverness timetable have pushed flights closer to the middle of the day, with very significant ramifications for my constituents who, for example, require medical treatment in Inverness. As a result of timetable changes, many consultants from Raigmore can also now not carry out clinics in Uist at all, and those travelling to and from Aberdeen for work have found the precious time they get to spend with their families cut even further by the new timetable. So what more can the Scottish Government do to ensure that lifeline services operated by private companies actually meet the needs of islanders?
Minister.
Absolutely take on board the question that Alistair Allen is answering. And while timetabling the commercial flights is a matter for airlines involved, the Scottish Government recognises that more can be done to bring transport planning and health service planning together. We're working closely with the Regional Transport Planning Partnership to scope out a plan of work. HiTrans, the Highlands and Islands Transport Partnership, recently convened a meeting of health boards in its area to discuss the establishment of a health and transport action plan, which would then allow public agencies and transport providers to better consider the effect of and any proposed mitigations to schedule changes. Similarly, I hope it would encourage those who contract the PSO routes to look at those schedules, how they fit in with the schedules of other transport operators to ensure the needs of passengers are met. As I've already said to Liam MacArthur, officials are scheduled for a meeting in Cornland to discuss healthcare provision in June, and we will update the member with those findings.
Supplementary, Beatrice Wisher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Alistair Allen raises an important point about the impact Loganair timetable changes can have on his constituents. I can confirm constituents in Shetland can also face disadvantage with regard to timetables. The Shetland-Aberdeen connection is vital for patients attending appointments at NHS Grampian, but unfortunately the aircraft does not overnight in Shetland, so any delays in the plane coming north first thing in the morning can seriously impact Shetland patients, and often their hospital appointments have to be rescheduled. So would the Scottish Government consider making representations to Loganair about this aspect of the Shetland-Aberdeen flight route?
Minister.
Yeah, I can absolutely confirm that the issue that Beatrice Wishart raised, I will ask the officials to take a look at that while they're having a look at all the other and things that we've spoken about already.
Question number 6, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implementation of ferry travel measures contained in the Fares Fair Review, including free foot passenger travel on inter-island ferries and the extension of the existing National Ferry Concessionary Scheme for island residents under 22 years old.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Draft Islands Connectivity Plan Strategic Approach, published for consultation on the 1st of February 2024, stated that we would take forward detailed consideration of a range of ferry fare proposals, including for under 22-year-old island residents to provide free foot passenger travel on inter-island ferries within the Outer Hebrides, Orkney and Shetland island groups, and also extend the existing National Ferry Concessionary Scheme. The online consultation concluded on the 6th of May, and responses are now being collated and analysed, and further detail on next steps and timescales will be confirmed in due course.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. The Fares Fair Review offered a number of proposals to address the cost of these lifeline services to island residents and young people, particularly those travelling on foot. In light of the recent announcement of changes to climate policy, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm this government's commitment to a just transition for island residents and the important role affordable public transport, including ferry services, plays in delivering on that agenda?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have personally been very struck, particularly in the Orkney Isles and Shetland, by the representations of young people who obviously regularly need to use their ferries in their journeys. And in terms of public transport, that's a key aspect. She will be aware, however, that in certain circumstances, it's the councils themselves that have the lead responsibility for ferry funding. We, as the Scottish Government, have supported that by providing support for revenue funding, but I think the steps that this government has taken, particularly on the inter-island support for Orkney and Shetland, will make a big deal of difference to young people in particular, and it's all about that fairness, equity and just transition that she refers to.
Question number 7, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and apologies for my very croaky voice. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps it is taking to improve road safety access across Stirling.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hyslop.
I feel for the member. The Scottish Government is committed to making Scotland's roads safe for all. This is supported through a record £36 million to road safety in order to reduce casualties and risks on our roads, and it is delivering against our priorities in the road safety framework. The funding includes the Road Safety Improvement Fund that Stirling Council can access to improve road safety on their respective roads. My officials engage with Stirling Council through the Local Partnership Forum meetings as well as other road safety forums. However, it is for Stirling Council to determine the priority that should be given to road safety measures, and local authorities have a statutory duty to promote road safety and take steps to both reduce and prevent collision to safeguard road users.
Evelyn Tweed.
There have been several fatalities on roads in my Stirling constituency in recent months. In some of these incidents, dangerous driving may have been a factor. To ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps the Government is taking to reduce dangerous driving.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, first of all, I would want to express sympathies to all those affected by tragic incidents and to the family and friends involved. Road safety remains an absolute priority. We are determined that we'll continue to make investments that support our road safety framework to 2030 to achieve safer road travel in Scotland now and in the future. And that investment is really key in terms of tackling behaviour, but also improvements. And it is, I don't want to pay any reflection, because obviously investigations will take place on a number of tragic incidents that have happened across Scotland more recently, but we continue to invest in that Road Safety Improvement Fund and in the Safety Camera Programme to encourage improved driver behaviour and ultimately enhance safety across Scotland and including in the Stirling area.
And supplementary, Mark Ruscoe.
Thank you. Across the Stirling area, there have been far too many crashes and near misses, including between Bridge of Allen and Keir Roundabout, where cyclists in particular need better protection through a segregated cycle route. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that there will be no rollback on Scottish Government funding for active travel infrastructure? And will she reassure me and the residents of Dunblane and Bridge of Allen that funding will be made available this year to progress that critical cycle route that can protect lives?
Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate the point the member makes, and in terms of capital investment and improvement, we are seeing substantial, as he knows, substantial investment in active travel. I think it's important to do that in a very smart way, and I think the collective planning in some areas in relation to bus and cycle lane improvements is definitely the way forward. I'm not as familiar with the particular area around Dunblane. I will look into that particular route that he's referring to, but I'm also acutely aware of the concerns that have been raised because of some particular incidences in that Dunblane area in relation to accidents.
And I can squeeze in question number 8 if I have succinct questions and answers. Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to improve facilities at railway stations operated by ScotRail.
Cabinet Secretary.
As stated in my recent letter to the member, wherever possible, the Scottish Government has invested in specialised facilities referred to as changing places, such as at the redevelopment of Glasgow Queen Street, Dundee Station and Troon Station when it opens this summer. Accessible toilets were also added to Motherwell and Stirling stations during the redevelopment work, and both the new East Kilbride Station building and the new Haremire Station will all have an accessible toilet and a baby changing facility. As my colleague is aware, all ScotRail trains are well equipped with onboard facilities, including fully accessible toilets and baby changing facilities for passengers. Fully accessible facilities are also available at all main railway stations in Scotland.
Katie Clark.
Figures released from ScotRail to my office show that just 22% of Scotland's 357 train stations have toilets which are open for public and staff use. Fewer than one in five stations have baby changing facilities, and just two stations have changing places facilities important for disabled passengers. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that these are basic passenger expectations, that we need to increase the number of these facilities in stations, and is that being made clear to ScotRail?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member has raised this issue and has done it in writing to me as well. It is a matter for ScotRail. We do know that in terms of investments, that is quite clearly when additional space has to be provided. Some stations, as you know, are quite historic in terms of their layout and indeed the space available for such facilities, but where redevelopments are possible, that has been a priority for them. But I will ensure that ScotRail are made acutely aware of the concern that the member raises.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes transport portfolio questions. And before we move on to the next item of business, which is a committee of the whole Parliament, I suspend this meeting of Parliament.